It is 9 o'clock. It is now time to start services. The call to worship. From the book of Psalms 150, verse 1 and verse 6, from the King James Version. And the ministry reads thusly: Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Amen and amen. Let us pray. Most gracious eternity God, we come here once again thanking you. We thank you for waking us up this day. We thank you for starting us along our way. We pray for those who are here and those who are on the way. I invoke our presence upon this gathering. I pray for the preached word. I pray that you touch the one who's being forfeit and touch those who receive it. I inhabit our praise. We thank you for the praise that goes up, but most of all, we thank you for the blessings that comes down. This I pray in my name of Jesus. Amen. Now I put the service in the hands of the deacons.
Good morning, Mount Nebo. Good morning, not Mount Nebo. I was just testing. If you are a visitor, you want your friend forever here. Amen and amen. I am Deacon Horton. I will be leading us in devotion this morning. We will be coming from the scripture of 1 John. We'll read the 1 John 1, 1 through 10. If you could stand with me for the reading of the scripture. 1 John 1, 1 through 10. Amen?
Amen.
Good morning. It reads as thus. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness and shew unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. This then is the message which we have heard of him, and declare unto you that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. Now, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. However, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar. And his word is not in us. May the Lord add a blessing to the reader here and doer of his word. And you may be seated. And this morning I was reaching into my memory banks of what I should sing this morning. And there was an older song that I know some of the other deacons have sung here, some of those more sage ones that are around. But I'm going to try and sing it this morning. Lord, hold my hand while I run this race. Oh, Lord, hold my hand while I run this race. Hallelujah. Hold my hand while I run this race. Oh, thank you.
We thank you this morning. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for allowing us to be here, allowing us to bring our loved ones, Heavenly Father, allowing us, Heavenly Father, to escape the death angel last night, Heavenly Father. Father, we ask a special prayer, Heavenly Father, for those that are infirm, for those that are in sick, Heavenly Father, and shut in. Go to them, Heavenly Father, because you're already there. But prop them up, Heavenly Father. Let them know that if they still here, that you still have something for them to do. Let them know, Heavenly Father, that the race is only gone. It's only over when you say it's over. So when the doctor says they can't do anything else, when the loved ones think that it's over, we know, Heavenly Father, that you have the ultimate say. So we thank you, Heavenly Father, for your permissive will. We thank you for your everlasting will. We thank you for your eternal will, Heavenly Father. Father, we ask a blessing for our pastor this morning, Heavenly Father, as he brings the bread of life. But not just him, Heavenly Father, but all those that are proclaimed to a dying world that you are still a living God. You are the same God that sent your son to walk up Golgotha the hill, the same God that put him on an old rugged cross, the same God that put him in a borrowed tomb, the same God that rose him up on that third day. And you're the same God right here he sits upon right now, making intercession for us. So we thank you for Jesus Christ, that name that's above all other names in heaven and in earth. Thank you, Jesus, because it's his, in his mighty name.
Good morning, Mount Nebo. Ask you stand for our praise and worship period. Anybody came to bless him on this morning, came to lift him up and exalt his name. The song says, I will call upon the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. And that's what we came to do on this morning. We came to lift him up and bless him.
come. And for all of us that's in the house and those that's worshiping via live stream, we ought to bless his holy name. His name is worthy. Let's hear from Sister Hall.
Giving honor to God, recognizing Pastor Arvey, Lady Arvey, their family, ministers in the pulpit, our virtual worshipers, and of course all of you, once again, good morning. Before our purpose and mission statement this morning, I have a card to read and an announcement to read. Thank you. Thank you for all your support, calls, food, and your very, very kind words. Sincerely, the Robinson family. And now to the announcement. First of all, did you know, Mount Nebo, that Pastor Arvey has been preaching for 39 years and pastoring for 25 years? Did you know that? Well, very soon, Mount Nebo, we will celebrate Pastor and Lady Arvey's 19th anniversary here at Mount Nebo. So get your pens and pencils ready for a few dates. Are you ready? Saturday, June 8th at 6 o'clock, we will celebrate our very own Lady Arvey with a musical here at Mount Nebo. Then again, the next day, Sunday, we will continue celebrating Lady Arvey. That's Saturday, June 8th for the musical. And the very next day, Sunday, we will continue celebrating her. So let's save those dates, everyone. Because we love and appreciate all that Lady Arvey does for us, and most of all, because the Lord has approved it. We are asking for a love offering of $100 from each of us. We can bless Lady Arvey on either the 8th or 9th as we celebrate her. We can also love on Lady Arvey even after these two dates, the Sunday after that and the Sunday after that and so forth. And that's not the end of the announcement. The 19th anniversary will continue for Pastor Arvey Wednesday, July 3rd at 7 o'clock p.m. Sunday, July 7th at 9 o'clock a.m. Then Wednesday, July 10th at 7 o'clock p.m. And lastly, Sunday, July 14th at 9 o'clock a.m. I'll briefly repeat those dates for you. For Pastor Arvey, we will celebrate Wednesday, July 3rd at 7 o'clock p.m. Sunday, July 7th at 9 o'clock a.m. Wednesday, July 10th at 7 o'clock p.m. And our final celebration will be Sunday, July 14th at 9 o'clock a.m. Praise God. Amen. Again, Mount Nebo, we know what to do. Because we also love Pastor Arvey, appreciate his wonderful leadership through these 19 years, as he fed us God's word, we are asking each of us to show that love and appreciation by blessing him with a love offering of $100. We again have the Lord's approval. We can bless Pastor Arvey on either one of the dates previously mentioned and afterwards as well. Urshas will have Pastor anniversary envelopes available for all of us. We just need to ask. Thanks for allowing me this time to share with you such a special occasion, our pastor and wife's 19th anniversary here at Mount Nebo. Praise God. Amen. And now, please join me in reading our purpose and mission statement. The purpose of the Mount Nebo Missionary Baptist Church is to bring men, women, and children to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, to develop them into the likeness of Christ, to train them in the biblical principles of worship, prayer, and Bible study, to encourage one another by engaging in fellowship, practicing stewardship, and rendering service, to glorify God and edify the body. Dream it, dare it, define it, do it. Thank you. At this time, we would like to recognize any visitors that we might have. If you are visiting with us this morning, we would love for you to stand and give us your name and any other information you choose. Amen. Good morning. Amen. Would you please remain standing? Is there another? Amen. On behalf of Mount Pastor and Lady Arvey and the Mount Nebo Missionary Baptist Church, we certainly appreciate you choosing Mount Nebo this morning for your place of praise and worship, and we invite you to come back at any time. We would love to have you. Thank you. Let's enjoy the rest of our service.
Amen. Well, now, y'all, she brought her grandbabies. Amen. Right. Let's give God a hand of praise for grandbabies. I have learned ain't nothing more special than that. For grandparents to love on and to be doting on grandparents, on grandbabies. Sister Patricia Hampton, many of you don't know that we have actually two Patricia Hamptons. That's a member of Mount Nebo. Patricia Hampton that's standing, and then Minister Hampton's mother is Patricia Hampton. So to differentiate the two, she told us to do this. I asked her, how can we differentiate? She said, just put Tiny in there. So that's Patricia Tiny Hampton. Amen. Let's stand. This fellowship time. We're waving at the live stream. Whatever you're doing in this season, your fist bumping, if you're shaking hands, if you're hugging, if you're kissing, whatever it is that you're doing, do it. What I'm going to ask Brother Clancy would come and Sister Kristen would come after him.
Well, praise the Lord. It's good to see everybody. I've got some great news. There will be a reboot of the men's ministry. And we are so jealous of the women's ministry, it's sad. I mean, the women's ministry has been doing their thing, and I regret to say it, we have not. But we're back in action now, I want to tell you that.
All right.
Hey, men, gonna need your help now. This is not for a few of us. This is for us. Let me tell you how we're going to get started. First of all of you are wearing this little blue funny little thing right here. And half of us don't know what it means. It is for prostate cancer awareness. And one of the first breakfasts we're going to have is a prostate cancer awareness breakfast. This is something we need to know. You can live with it and it can kill you. So we got to be very, very careful. And there's certain things we need to know. There's sometimes some intimate things we need to know that women talk about readily that we don't like to touch or talk about. But we are. We're also going to be responsible for sending interesting messages to people. Maybe you don't know, but Sister Dovey is in Village Vicente. And you may not know that she's blind. So we're going to take a message to her, an audio tape from Brother Ellis and Brother Daly, just greeting her, letting her hear the voices again, letting her know that we care about her and we miss her. Oh, yes, we're excited about that. So, women, look out. We're getting this thing together here. So, not only are you light years ahead of us, but we're going to catch up here for your soon. So, you'll be hearing more. You'll be working with the pastor to get the first prostate cancer awareness breakfast ready. We're going to ask the healthcare professional to assign, to find a man for us to do this. This is kind of a man thing, all right? We love them dearly, but for this topic, we're going to have to find a gentleman who can do this. And I want to mention three names. One, you didn't know. When the doctor diagnosed me with prostate cancer, we did a little thing. I said, I want active surveillance. We're going to watch it. Yeah. Well, we watched it in a group. And I had to talk to somebody. So there are three brothers in this church that I went to. Brother Bradley, you still there? Brother Bradley is one of them. He's walked through this fire and came out on the other side. Brother RJ, are you here, RJ? Brother RJ's not here, but he walked through this valley and came out on the side. And Brother Brown. And my other Brother Brown, way in the back here, all right? Now, what you got to know is, you know, sometimes you don't want to talk about these things to anybody. You try to go tiptoe through these things alone. But they were so helpful to me and so kind. So after 28 days of radiation, I walked out on the other side. Hallelujah. So thanks to these men and the like. So, ladies, look out.
Now let's receive Sister Kristen.
Church. I'm here this morning on behalf of the Women's Ministry to make a formal announcement. We will be having our womanhood celebration on May 4th here at Mount Nebo at 12 o'clock. Our theme is loving, lifting, and leading for such a time as this. Background scripture comes from Esther chapter 4, verse 14. I would like for you all to save the date. We will, starting this week, start sending out forms and QR codes for you to sign up. Deadline will be on April 21st, and so please keep a lookout for those QR codes and for the forms, and if you have any questions or concerns, please reach out to either myself or to Sister Newton. Thank you. Have a blessed week.
Amen. Give our men and women's ministry another hand. Come on, give them another hand. Got to announce this, a few things. Sister Mary Morris, I don't see her with us today, but she shared with me, I think it was Saturday morning, that her brother-in-law, Floyd Ragland, living in St. Louis, Missouri, went the way of the earth. So we want to be praying for the Mary Morris family. Then we want to be praying, I think I see Sister Jordan all the way to the back, yes. Want to be praying for the Jordan Wilmore family in the passing of Brother Mark Wilmore. Those of you that don't know who he is, I'm going to remind you two ways of who he is. That's Vanessa's husband. Amen. Vanessa, the daughter of Sister Jordan. And then years ago, he made a presentation to us in the Whittington Room about insurance. That's the same young man who went the way of the earth. Lord, it's summoning them from labor to reward, and so we certainly want to be praying for Sister Vanessa, the Wilmore family, and the Jordan family for what they're experiencing now. Amen. Then I want to ask you to continue praying for Brother Deacon Jared Dillard, Deacon Leroy Martin, Brother Bobby McDowell, Sister Carlene Charles, Brother James Franchard is with us. I want to continue to pray for and with him. Richard and Florida Brown, Milburn Frampton, she's with us. And I think she's got two of her sons with her today. Amen. Well, I'm looking for them now. They must have walked out and went to the bathroom. Amen. Tell them to come back in church, y'all. They got character. They are nice character fellas. Love to talk to them. Sister Mary Copeland, don't call her name out a whole lot. Want to be praying for her. Victoria Jones, Ruthie Gunn, Maruby Smith, Mildred Harder, Sonora Garrett, David Johnson, all of those praying. Now, I want to continue to keep before us church school. Y'all say church school.
Church school.
Our numbers are, our numbers is steadily rising. Thank Brother Doug Chambers, leadership, and all of those with Christian education for doing that. This past Wednesday, I think Sister Stovall touched that lesson, and Brother French taught that lesson, and others taught that lesson, the faith of four friends. From the book of Luke, and then we have some stuff coming up this Wednesday. All teachers are well prepared. Want to invite you to come. We're over 60 in our numbers for sure, probably encroaching 70. And our goal is always to get 50% of those who attend on Sunday morning. Amen. Sunday we come for worship. Wednesday we come for instruction. Amen. Say we come for instruction on Wednesday. And then we throw back to God on Sunday what we took in on Wednesday, back to the one who put it in us. Amen. So I want to continue to encourage us about our church school. On next Sunday, the Good News Global Jail Ministry will be with us, and we know what we do, and so I'm going to ask you to prepare to do that, sharing a special offering with them. Next Sunday also, I've accepted assignment to preach at the Greater New Hope Church. Their mission program, and they called me just about, I think every year to preach for them. This year they asked me to preach. I wasn't available, and they made it available date for me. And so I want to ask that our mass choir would come. Mass choir. And all of you who can come and go and share with the Greater New Hope Church, that's at 3 p.m. on next Sunday. Two last things, and then we're ready to move forward. Anniversaries. Deacon Harton and Sister Harton. Stand up, Sister Harton. I see Deacon Harton coming in the church. Y'all stand up. April 22nd. Stand up, Sister Harton. April 22nd, that'll be 24 years. Amen. Brother Horton heard me talking about not he bringing all that rated R stuff in church. What's wrong with him, y'all? He heard me talking about it in the back. He heard me say that he started running out of the festival to come and be next to his bride. Amen. 24 years. You don't get to 24 years without knowing somebody. Amen. So happy anniversary to you all that's come forthcoming. And then the last thing I want to mention, you remember Sister Hall said it and it caught my attention. I'm 56 years old. I've been 56 for a long time. I was 56 before I was 56 and will be 56 after I'm 56 or 57. But anyway, Sister Hall said it earlier. Since I've been here, I've been preaching 39 years. Of the 39, 25 of those years, officially, I've been a pastor. But my daddy, he allowed me to get pastoral training for the 14 years that I was at Cathedral. And he allowed me to do everything a pastor does except give direction with the money. Now, when I get to heaven, we get to heaven, I ain't gonna be crazy with Clarence. I ain't gonna ask him nothing. I'm just gonna say, why you did it like that? But now, here's where I'm going. Since I've been here, those of you who's been here the whole tenure, I have taught and preached about tithing and offering three separate occasions. One time, I did it within, and God put it on my heart to do it, led me in the spirit. The first 8 months I was a pastor here, I did it. Then I did it again, and then the last time I did it during the summer months. And the summer months of our giving went through the roof. Amen. Let me say this to us, and I'm not saying this because I'm asking for anything. I'm just saying this so we know. Tithing is an individual thing. Amen. It's not a family thing. Though a family does, like my family, I think everybody in my family is just about tithers, and they all tithe individually. My wife and I, we all tithe individually. When it comes to tithing, that's an individual thing. And I know years ago, Southern Baptist came out with a family giving plan, and I know about all that stuff. But when you read the word, whatever God has given to an individual, that's what God expects via tithe and offering. So I'm going to ask, some of us are still giving tithe by way of family. I'm going to ask us to consider to be biblical. One thing that I love about Mount Nebo is that I came to a biblical church. Amen. I came to a biblical church. That had nothing to do with me. Dr. John Whittington, my predecessor, 46 years, he had to teach some Bible for the church to be biblical. And so we praise and we thank God for being Bible church. And thank God and praise God for my predecessor. I've never seen a church that's biblical go left or right. I've seen many churches who are not biblical suffer many things. But I've never seen a biblical church go left or right, because when you're Bible, it obligates God to do everything he said he would do in his word. And he said, if you give me, I will open up the windows of heaven. That's what he said, y'all. And if you don't believe he's telling the truth, try tithing and watch God open up them windows. And he's such a generous God, he will even do some things for you that he didn't say. He'll open up some doors. He will rebuke some devourers. He will uncurse some curses. God will do what he said he would do. We have to have the faith and the trust to believe in him. And you know what I do? I'm not teaching tithing, y'all, but you know what I do? The first thing I do, that's the first thing I take out. That's the first thing I take out. And I will say this to you all. There's been some, I don't know why people think preachers have a whole lot of money. That's not true, y'all. But what I've seen God do, and I've seen God do it in some of my kids' life. I've seen God be faithful to individuals who's faithful to giving. Ray Daniel and Terry went through college. Taylor went through college. Jennifer is going through college. And what? And she'll be graduating, I think, May of 2025. Girl, Daddy, proud of you. Yeah, Daddy, proud of you. And she got two little boys now and a husband. Where you at? But I've watched them grow, and I'm grateful for that. I done lost my train of thought now. But I've seen God do some things for me. When I give and I have the rest of the month left, and I watch God open up some doors that I didn't know where it was coming from. Even before I came to Omaha, that's happened all of my life since I was a tither. And so I want to encourage us to, our church is a tithing church. I just want to encourage us to continue doing and encourage us to be individual tithers and watch God work. Amen. Watch God work. Let me say this and I'll be through. Many preachers are afraid to teach about certain topics at their church. We're afraid to teach about tithing. We're afraid to teach about authority. And we're afraid to just teach about some tough things that we know Baptist folk have some issues with. But hallelujah, doggone it, I ain't got those issues, y'all. And Mount Nebo ain't got those issues. We are a church that want to stay Bible and watch God bless us as he blesses us. Amen. Now y'all give God a hand of praise for being a Bible church, being a Bible church. Amen. Now, my son Ray Daniel, Lord has opened some doors for him already preaching. He's gonna be preaching every Sunday this month. And none of them over here, y'all. He gonna be preaching the third Sunday in Atlanta, and then second Sunday, and the fourth Sunday at Pastor McCrew's church, St. John. Pastor McCrew had some issues with prostate, and so he needed someone to pinch it from him. He called me, I think it was Thursday or Friday, and he asked for Minister Redania. Amen. So y'all pray for him. This is something that he had not embarked upon, and it's going to be a good experience for him. Amen. And I've said this, and I'm telling y'all, we have a brilliant stock of preacher stallions in our pulpit. Some of y'all don't know about horses. Stallion is one of the most valuable horses. They're not horses, they're preachers. Preacher Fireside Preach, and collectively they make up a great group, and I'm appreciative for them. Amen. Y'all say amen for our preachers. Now I'm going to ask our choir to do what they prepared to do. After they will have done what they prepared to do, then I'll be back to preach, and then we serve in the Lord's Supper, and we go and do whatever we're going to do the rest of the day. Amen.
can solve it.
Choir hand as they demount. They mounted, not a demounting, the choir loft. Happy to have with us, he's been attending our midweek worship with us, Minister Minister Marvin Duncan. He's out of the Mount Moriah Church, but he wanted to share with us, and I'm happy he's here. Amen. Y'all give him a warm Mount Nebo welcome. When I get through preaching, I want you to do the invitation to the discipleship. Will you handle that for me? You can handle that for me. All right, all right. I don't know why I have to cry sometimes. I don't know why, Lord, I have to sigh sometimes. Oh, it'll be perfect day. Trouble is out of my way. I don't know why. They can play anything, just give them a chance to do it. Thank y'all, man. Isaiah 41, I'm in preaching speed now. Isaiah 41, and I want to accentuate just verse 10. God has brought me back to the scripture in the pandemic. God led me there in the pandemic, at the beginning of the pandemic, to share with you from the same verse. And I want to share it again. God has put on my heart I originally was going to preach, put it all in his hands. When I sat in that rehearsal, I was going to preach that. And then I thought about preaching Sunday school lesson. And the Lord shared with me on last night, I want you to tell my people reasons as to why they are making it like they're making it. That's what I want to talk about, reasons as to why we are making it like we're making it. Here's what he says to us in Isaiah chapter 41. And when you have arrived there, just say, I'm there. This is what he says, if I can get this phone to work right. Verse number 10. I don't need it. I know the text that I want to preach. Here it says, fear thou not. And here's why you ought not fear. For I am with thee. Then he gives us something else that's much more comforting. He says, be not dismayed. I should have sung that song today. Be not dismayed, whatever betides you, God. But be not dismayed. For I am thy God. In other words, y'all didn't choose me. I chose you. Watch what he says. Then he says, I will strengthen thee. Yea. Bible slang talk, y'all. I will help thee. Yea. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. And in that one verse are at least four reasons why we're making it like we're making it. Amen. Give God a hand of praise. You take your seat. Brothers and sisters, it is my preaching delight, my preaching joy to say that we are not making it how we're making it because of anything that we're doing. Somebody said, you better talk. That is my intentions. Some folk think they making it because of their money. But let me just give you something that ought to be ringing in your head. You will die one day, and that money will keep going on. They will bring you and deposit your body, burn it up to ashes, and that money will be spent in ways that you never thought about. So you're not making it because of your l'argent. Then I want to say to you, you're not making it today because of your social status. I know all of us want to be somebody. I know, matter of fact, all of us already are somebody. And whatever we are not that because we made ourselves that. But whatever we are, however we are, where we are what we are because God made us what we are. He made us what we are. He placed us where we are. He situated us how we are. And it does not matter how you are, you ain't got no right to be jealous because of the oddness of someone else. I wish I had a witness right there. You ain't got no reason to be jealous because God has put a little more oddness in someone else, or a little less oddness in you. Whatever God has made you, you ought to learn how to be satisfied with what the Lord has given unto you. I ain't the best preacher in the world. I ain't the best hoopalistic preacher in the world. I am not the best expositional preacher in the world. I am
not the best pastor in the world, but watch this, y'all. I'm the best preacher from Mount Nebo. I'm the best pastor from Mount Nebo. And so I've learned I don't have to be the pastor of Salem. I don't have to be the pastor of Morningstar. I don't have to be the pastor of Pilgrim. I can just learn how to be satisfied with my honors that God has made me pastor right here at the Mount Nebo Missionary Baptist Church. We are not what we are because of social media. And some of us spend too much time on social media. Y'all, it's good. I didn't spend a whole lot of time on it until the live stream started occurring. And I wanted to know, some things about our church. I've told y'all, don't send me no prayer request, no request, because I'm not going to respond. I don't hang out on, see how y'all got quiet? Pastor ought to move on from social media and just leave me alone. But whatever your social media status is, no matter how many friends you have, no matter how many folk visit your page, no matter what pops up on your timeline, I shouldn't know all this stuff, but I do. No matter what goes on your Facebook, your YouTube, that stuff didn't make you who you are. It's but by the grace of God that you're making it like you are making it. Anybody know anything about grace? Grace woke you up. Grace started you on your way. Grace brought you to the church. Grace is keeping you right now. Y'all acting like you don't know what grace is. Somebody ought to shout for God's amazing grace. Your name, your family heritage, your intellect is not the reason you are making it like you're making it. While you're making it, how you're making it. That ain't got nothing to do with it. You can be the smartest thing that ever came up in America. You can be smarter than Albert Einstein. You can make Socrates take a back seat. You can be the most educated thing that ever walked on these mundane shores, but that is not the reason you gonna make it like you make it. So that you all know what your reason is, can I tell you why the reason that you're making it like you're making it today? You're making it because of the Lord God Almighty. Can I ask y'all a question? I want to answer by a response. Anybody glad you're making it like you're making it and God is making you make it? Y'all still didn't hear me. Let me try again. Anybody glad you're making it like you're making it and you're glad God is making it for you and making it with you? You ought to give God a shout because he didn't have to let you be what you are. He didn't have to give you what you got. He didn't have to let you be as smart as you are. He didn't have to give you the experience that you have. But because you're making it like you're making it, we ought to take a little time and throw up those hands and give God some enthusiastic, exciting praise because he's letting us make it how we're making it. Are y'all still with me? Well, let me go to the text. By the time you get to the text, Bible readers, you know by now the writer is a prophet, a free man by the name of Isaiah. Y'all remember Isaiah, don't you? Isaiah is the one who said, I went to church and I finally saw the Lord. He says, I was able to see the Lord because that which was obstructing my view, God got it out the way. And I want to tell you something. Whenever you can't see the Lord, God will get out of your way whatever it is that's in your way, that's stopping your way to see him. You ought to see God every time you come to church. You ought not be paying attention to what I got on, what everybody else got on, and all that stuff. But when you come down to Mount Nebo or sit in your pew, seat, wherever you sit, you ought to want to experience seeing the Lord. Anybody saw the Lord in this service? Can I tell you how you see him? You see him when folk throw up their hands. You see him when folk holler, hallelujah. You see him when his word is being preached. You see him when the choir sings songs like, I've learned how to put it all in his hands. You see him when you feel his presence. And you ought to tell folk on your pew that this is not a pouting pew, but this is a shouting pew. And if you came to pout, complain about what folk are doing or what they ain't doing or what is or ain't happening at the church, you ought to get off my pew, because I came to see the Lord and to shout. Isaiah, when he writes this passage, Israel is facing three times the trouble. One, they are bound in Babylonian captivity and about to face an enemy that does not fear God. That's bad, y'all, when you don't fear God. Two, they are bound by their spiritual disobedience to God, and as a result, they're in captivity. And let me tell you this, whenever we are disobedient to God and his word, you can rest assured it might go 40 years, it might go 60 years, it might go 80 years, it might go 100 years. But if you remain in disobedience, in essence, at some time, God gonna put you in some type of captivity. And then three, they're bound in captivity. They are spiritual disobedient, and because of that, they are facing some turbulent, trying times. And so when Isaiah gets to chapter 41, he tries to give us a little contrast. It comes in the play. He gives us a contrast that God is trying to tell his people, not only who he is, but he's trying to tell his people what he's getting ready to do. In other words, if y'all let me put it like this, brother preachers, God is the only one that got the right to do this. God starts bragging on himself. And in bragging on himself, he intimates to the Bible reader, not only am I by myself, but I'm in a class all by myself. Y'all heard this before, and I need to tell y'all this stuff again. You say Beyonce, I say Pamela RV. You say Denzel Washington, I say Terry RV. You say C.L. Franklin, I say Hernest RV. You say Michael Jordan, I say Kobe Bryant. But if you mess around and say the Lord Jesus Christ, I can't say Allah, I can't say Buddha, I can't say Confucius, I can't say no other unreal God. I gotta say the Lord Jesus Christ, because he is in a class all by himself. And he says to them, I want you to know who I am. Because all these other nations that's got gods around them, they got gods that's made, watch this, out of gold and wood. They got eyes, but they can't see. They got feet, but they can't walk. They got hands, but they can't touch. And I don't know how y'all feel about it. Live stream, I don't know how you feel about it. But I don't want to worship a God who got his eyes and can't see me when I need him to see me. I don't want to worship a God who's got some hands that can't reach way down and pick me up when I need to be picked up. I don't want to worship a God who's got some feet that can't walk with me through the fire. I want a God that can go wherever I am. He wants them to know he's in the class all by himself. That's verses 1 through 7. And then when you get to verses 8 through 10, he says, because of who I am in essence, you ain't got. Boy, bad English sounds so good when you're preaching. You ain't got no reason to fear. He says, fear thou not. Why? Because I am with thee. You got your Bibles open. I'm about to pick this verse apart. Then it says, not only fear thou not because I'm with thee, but be not dismayed because I am your God. And then it says, because I'm your God, you got some benefits. Can I give y'all the benefits? And in this verse, this is reasons as to why we're making it as we're making it. He says, I will strengthen you. I will not only strengthen you, but I will uphold you, and I will support you. He says, fear thou not, I am with thee. Be not dismayed. I am thy God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. And then I will uphold you by the power of the righteousness of my right hand. Anybody glad that God is the one that's making us for what we're doing? It's because of God we're doing what we're doing. And watch this, y'all. I know we were fearing in the pandemic, but if you're a saved, born-again Christian, that wasn't the time to fear. That was the time to stand up in faith. Let me say it again because y'all got quiet. If you born again at the height of the pandemic, you shouldn't have been running from the pandemic. You should have been running with the pandemic, because first of all, you should know if God let it be, he's got purpose wrapped up in it. And if he let it be, he knows how to keep you. I mean, if he kept the fiery boys walking in the fire, they made the fire 7 times hotter. He kept them and they walked out. And then the next morning, the king said, didn't we throw in 3? But I see 4. And the 4th one looks like the son of the living God. God will walk with you when the fire gets hot. So let me give you the reasons as to why we making it like we making it. It's 4 reasons. If you're writing, cool. But you don't have to write, because you can go back to the live stream and stop it and pause it. Get all the announcements so you'll be up to date with all the announcements. You can make it pause and you can read the announcements 50 million times if you want to, or listen to my voice 95 million times if you want to. Thank God for technology. Can I give you the reasons why we're making it? First one, we're making it because of the presence of God. Y'all say presence of God. Look what he says, fear not. He tells Israel, fear not, I am with thee. In other words, he says, because I'm with you, you ain't got no reason to fear, and you ought to be trusting in me. We put our trust in the wrong entities. When we can't pay our bill, when children go astray, whenever negative things, we put our trust in the wrong entity. I've never seen a time where you put an individual that's saved, put their trust in God, God doesn't come through. Now, he may not come through like you want him to come through. He may not come through how you think he ought to come through. But if you trust in God, God will come through. The only thing is, you ain't got no business to be fearing. Let me come this way. Anybody other than me that had a lot of trouble in life? I mean, a whole lot of trouble. I've had so much trouble and said, when trouble come now, I get happy because I've seen what the Lord has done in the past with my trouble. And if he worked it out for me in the past, I ain't got no reason to be fearing in the present, because if he did it in the past, he can do it in the present. And when he do it in the present, that means he can take care of the future. He can take care of all three tenses, the past, the present, and the future. He knows what you need, and he knows when you need it. So we ain't got no reason to fear. He says, fear not. Now watch this. It's a command, y'all. It's a command. And he gives them this command when he knows the people are afraid. Fear not. You Bible readers, watch this. Live stream Bible, watch this. According to Strong's expanded, exhaustive concordance. What did I just say? There's a book written by Strong called Strong's Expanded Exhaustive Concordance. And when you look up the word fear, right in that book, he says in the Bible there is at least 365 fear nots in the Bible. See, God said, I know they're going to be trying to fear me on Monday, so I'm going to give them a fear not on Monday. God says, I know they're going to be trying to fear things in the month of July. I'm going to give them another fear not for every day in July. I know they're going to get Christmas time, and they ain't going to have enough money to do what they want to do. They're going to be fearing, but I'm going to give them another fear not for Easter, for Valentine's Day, for Mother's Day, for Father's Day, for Thanksgiving and Christmas. I'm going to give them a fear not for every day of the year. And since God has given us a fear not for every day of the year, why are you walking around here pulling out your hair, drinking your troubles away? Why are you trying to smoke up your troubles? God said, fear not. And just let me give you some common sense stuff. Boy, I done got a little bit too fat around the waist, so I got to hide this. Let me give y'all some common sense stuff. Watch this. Anybody know about fear? Anybody know about faith? Now, if you know about fear, and faith, fear and faith, hold hands. Y'all ain't nothing wrong with y'all, man. Y'all good. Fear and faith can't hold hands. Fear and faith can't coagulate together. They're not bosom friends. They're not buddies. Matter of fact, let hands go. Y'all look at one another. Matter of fact, they are diametrically, directly opposed to each other. If you got fear, you ain't got no faith. And if you got some faith, you ain't got no business fearing. Fearing, the acronym for fear, is false evidence appearing real. But anybody know about anything about faith? The substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Faith moves the unmovable. It conquers the unconquerable. Faith lifts up that can't be lifted up. And if you got a mustard green grain seed of faith, the Bible says you ain't got no business trying to climb the mountain. Speak to the mountain, whatever that trouble is, and your faith, not your fear, your faith will cause the mountain to start skipping and hopping out of your way. Somebody ought to tell God, thank God I can have a little faith in him. Now, God, via the Bible, has given us a remedy for fear. Fret and faint. Y'all got time for me to quote these things? You ever heard the Bible say, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will no evil. You ever heard the Bible say, God is my refuge and my strength, a very present help in the time of trouble? Then you go to the next verse, it says, because he's all of that, therefore will not we fear the earth, because he's God, y'all. Then when you drop down to verse 10, it says, be still and know that I am God. You ever heard the psalmist say, Psalm 34, verse 19, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord deliver him out of them. You ever heard Hebrews 13 and 5 say, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. So why are we fearing? Isaiah 43 and verse 2 says, when you pass through the waters, I'm going to be with you. And though the rivers may be great, they shall not overflow thee. In other words, whatever is before you, whatever trouble you got in front of you, if you just don't fear me, I'll move that all out your way and let you walk on dry ground. We can't fear life. Let me give you an illustration and I'll move on from that point. Let me use Abigail and me. Where's Abigail? I'll use you another time. She wasn't paying attention, y'all. And that little girl read her Bible every night. Go on, girl. And she come to me, Daddy, the Bible say, and I be saying to myself, girl, you better slow down. but watch this. There was a girl, little young girl, walking with her daddy. And they were walking, and they would walk every day. And on this particular day, the daddy said to the daughter, he said, you know where you are? She said, no, daddy. He said, you know where we're going? She said, no, daddy. He said, you know how to get back home? She said, no, daddy. And the daddy said, well, if you don't know where we are, you don't know where we're going, if you don't know how to get back home, how can you be so calm in this walk? That little girl looked at her daddy and said, daddy, I can be calm. I may not know where we are. I may not know where we're going. I may not know how to get back home. But one thing I do know, I'm with my daddy. And when you got God on your side, that's your daddy, y'all. When you got the Lord walking with you, you ought not be afraid, because you know you're with your daddy. That's how you're making it. You're making it because of his presence. Oh, Lord. Not right now, man. You're making it because of the presence. You're making it because of this presence, but then you're making it because of the person of God. You still got your Bible open? Y'all promise? He says, fear thou not, I am with thee. That's my presence. But then here's the second reason why you're making it. Thank you, media. He says, be not dismayed, because I am thy God. That word dismayed in the original Hebrew language is a word that's called sha'ar. And what it paints the picture, it paints the picture of a deer in headlights. And you've ever seen a deer in headlights? They freeze. They don't move. and they have no sense of what's going on. It's just an out of control situation for that deer. And what Isaiah is trying to say, believers, you don't have to be like a deer in headlights. I know you're in captivity. I know this stuff ain't good for you. I know you know the history of your people. But Isaiah says you don't have to be a deer in headlights. You know why? Because God got this thing all under control. Can I ask somebody, do you really know God got your life under control? I didn't get too much of a loud witness. Let me ask y'all, anybody know God got your life under control? And so many times we think whatever is holding us up, because it's too big, just like Israel thought that that captivity was too big for them, so it was too big for God. And many of us think the same way. Whatever that betides us, whatever dismays us, because we can't handle it, we think it's too big for God. But watch this, y'all. There's not a doggone thing that could ever be a thing, that is a thing, that was a thing, shall be a thing. God can't handle it. He sits high, but he looks low. Heaven is his seating spot, and earth is his footstool. He rides on the waves. He plants his foot on the sea, and he rides every storm. Is there anybody in here glad that God is in control? And watch this, y'all. Because God is in control, watch this. We don't have to be a deer in headlights, because God is in control. The devil thought he had God. When Jesus was hanging on the cross, let's go back to Calvary, y'all. And by the way, I wish I had thought about this when I was the other Sunday. Calvary is the most beautiful mountain that's ever been a mountain that shall be a mountain. Mount Horeb exists. Mount Sinai exists. Mount Everest exists. But all of those mountains pales into the mountain of Calvary, because it's at Calvary where we received our sight and had our burdens roll away. It's at Calvary where they stretched Jesus wide. They hung him high. He dropped his head in the locks of his shoulder, and he did die. And if that's all you see is just the blood running down, if that's all you see is the nails in his hands, if that's all you see is the nails in his feet, you're missing out on the most beautiful part of Calvary. The most beautiful part of Calvary, that he did die out on Calvary. But you never want Jesus to die, because 3 days later, the Bible says he will get up. But watch this. The devil thought he had the last word out at Calvary. How many of y'all play chess? Come on. How many of y'all play chess? Not checkers. Chess. I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about chess. You see, checkers, it makes you think, but it don't build your thinking like chess does. Because you got to figure out from your side of the board how to get to the other side of the board without getting all your men or your pieces swiped up. And putting the king in a checkmate move where he ain't got no else to move, because if he does move in any direction, the game is over. The devil thought he had Jesus in checkmate on Friday, but all Sunday morning he found out that the king had another move. Have I got a witness in here? And whenever your situations get so bad, don't think that that's the last word, because God always has the last word, and God will always give you another move. We're making it.
because of his presence. He's with us. We're making it because of his person. He is our God. But then the third reason why we're making it, because of his power. Watch this. Watch this. Put that verse up there. Let me walk through this right quick. Put that verse up there. Watch this. He says, I will strengthen thee. It's a lot wrapped up in that. Not only will he strengthen us, but he will help us. Now go back up to the first couple of phrases. Watch this. First couple of phrases, he's present tense. He says, I am with thee. I am thy God. But then he has a shift. And God specializes in shifting things. Anybody in this room, you thought you were going under and God shifted things and now you were the head and not the tail? Anybody thought that that weapon was going to destroy you, but God shifted things and you were able to say, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. You know why? Because God knows how to shift things when things need to be shifted. You ought to thank God for the shifting business of the Lord God Almighty. He says, let me shift this thing. Watch this. He says, I am. And then he shifts it to, you caught it. He shifts it to, I will. Come on, y'all say that with me. He says, I am. Twice. Then he shifts it to, I will. Three times. Now, watch this. That I am tells you who God is. Yeah. The I will tells you what he will do. Y'all didn't catch it, so let me come back around. I am tells you who God is. But I will tells you what God can do. And watch this. You can't separate who he is from what he will do. Y'all still didn't catch it. You can't separate, because if you're caught, you'd be running all over this building. You can't separate who God is from what God will do. Well, let's see if we can make a point. God is a Savior. And because he's a Savior, he will save you. God is a healer. Because he's a healer, he will heal you. God is a deliverer. Because he's a deliverer, he will deliver you. God is a provider. Because he's a provider, he will provide for you. God is a protector. And because he's a protector, he will protect you. You can't separate the I am from the I will. He says, God will. Boy, I feel that thing coming on now. I will strengthen you. And the reason, watch this. When he says, I will strengthen you, catch this, y'all. Watch this. This part blew me away as I was studying this. He says, because I'm going to strengthen you, that ought to tell you that he, if we need strengthening, then obviously we weak. I know you don't think you're weak. I know you think this, you got this thing going on by the gang gang. Y'all don't understand that. That's Lake Charles talk. I know you don't. I know you got this thing going on, and you make things roll, and you call it, you rolling fat. Y'all give me some more slang talk. You got it going on. You rolling fat. You come on, Arnell. Y'all know this slang talk. Arnell said, "No, Pastor, don't embarrass me like that." But watch this. If he says he has to strengthen us, that means there's weakness. Here's the shouting news. Our weakness is God's invitation to lift us up.
Y'all didn't catch that because I wanted to shout my doggone self. I said our weakness is God's invitation to pick us up. It's God's invitation to turn us around. It's God's invitation to start us all over again. It's God's invitation to take us from the bad, put us in the good. It's God's invitation to bring us where we've never been before. If you want some strength, just live in weakness, and God will take your weakness and turn it into some strength. But then, now, Abigail, come here, girl. Now I'm going to use Abigail. That's my last biological seed. That's the last time I'm going to know. Get on your knees, baby. Why y'all, she understand. Why y'all tripping? Watch this. Abigail is Abigail. And Taylor, Jennifer, Terry, Ray Daniel, Kristen, they all take advantage of Abigail. Not in a bad way. They do it in a good way. Whenever they want something they know they can't get from Daddy. Am I lying? No, I ain't lying. Taylor over there, no daddy. Jennifer tell, she tell, when they want to get something from daddy that they know daddy ain't gonna give them, they send Abigail. Now watch, this was years ago. I was keeping Abigail, and I will never forget this. He'll strengthen you, but he'll also help you. And look at daddy, baby. Look at that. Turn around. Look at that. She did something she wasn't supposed to do. My last little seed, y'all, she's starting to look like her daddy. You had nappy. Ain't going nowhere. So she did something she wasn't supposed to do. And where is Minister Chavez? When I got Layla and she don't do right, I can't whip Layla. That's the grandbaby. I can't whip Layla, but this one I can. So I got a belt, and I was getting ready, Sister Stovall, to put it to her. Look at me, baby. Look at me with them big old eyes. And she looked at her daddy with her eyes, and she wasn't about maybe that tall. That's why I asked you to get on your knees. And she looked at daddy, and she looked at her daddy with them eyes. She opened up them big eyes. Her head was already up. Now throw up your hands. She threw up her hands like that and said, Daddy, help me. Guess what, y'all? I couldn't do anything else to her. You know why? Because that's my child. And she was down low, but she lifted up her head. She lifted up her eyes. She lifted up her hands and said, Daddy, help me. Is there anybody in this house, you ever been in a situation where your daddy was getting ready to rain down on you? I ain't talking about your biological, I'm talking about God. And you looked up to God with your eyes. You looked up to God with your head. You threw up your hands and you cried out, Daddy, help me. And he reached way down and he helped his child out. Last thing and I'm out. We're making it the way we're making it because of his presence. Say that. Presence. What's the second one? See if y'all with me.
Person.
It's person. What's the third one?
Power.
It's power. Let me give you the fourth one. It's right in the text. We're making it the way we're making it because of his protection. He says, I will uphold you.
Yeah.
With what hand? The righteous right hand. He strengthens to heal us. He helps, he supports us to help us. But then he sustains us to hold us. I got you, Sister Stovall. When you get him, come here, man. Ain't nothing wrong with me now. Ain't nothing wrong with you. I'm all man, you all man, right?
Right.
We good?
Good.
All right. When you get him, when you get him, hold on.
Yeah.
And don't let go.
Don't let go. Yeah.
When the winds blow, hold on. And don't let go. When the trials come, hold on. And don't let go. Because if you hold on long enough, God will turn everything around that's making you have a little trouble. I'm out, y'all. I'm out. Y'all remember Moses? Every time, but Duggan, come here, let me use you, man. Yeah. I know, I'm using the small guys. Straight out like that. Y'all remember Moses?
Yeah.
Get on that side. When they were fighting the Amalekites, when Moses' hands, when he was able to lift them up, they were winning the war. When his hands got weak and they had to lift them down, he had to lift them down, they started losing the war. But then he had some help come. Then he had some help come. And they set him down on a rock. But not only did they set him down on a rock, they lifted up his hands. And because they lifted up his hands, they were able to win the battle. Can I ask you, let me tell you something? You ought to hang around folk that ain't gonna take your hands down, but it's gonna lift your hands up. And when they lift your hands up, God will give you the victory through all of your trouble, your trials. But you gotta have folk around you that's gonna lift up your hands. Thank y'all, man. Thank y'all. I'm through, y'all. But the right hand is the hand of power. It's the hand of authority. It's the hand of inheritance. Right there. Whoa, it's the hand of provision. That's why the Bible says, weeping may endure for one. But if you hang on in there, joy will come in the morning. Can I get a witness in here? And I just believe that I'm looking at some weepers in the room. If you don't mind nobody knowing your business, have you ever wept all day long? When I call your weeping time, you ought to get up on your feet. Have you ever wept all day long? Have you ever wept early in the night? Have you ever wept all night long? But if you keep on weeping, what the Bible says, weeping may endure for night, but joy, anybody got joy? Will come in the morning. You ought to trust God because he's worthy to be trusted. No wonder the lyrics of the songwriter said, I trust in God wherever I may be, out on the land or over the stormy sea. Come with me from day to day. My heavenly Father watches over me. Is there anybody in the kid know that Father is watching over you? I wish I had a shouting witness. Oh, anybody in
yeah. Know that the Father is watching you. Oh, say yeah. Grab that neighbor by the hand. Look that neighbor in the eye. Say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but God is watching over me. God is watching, and he's watching over you. Preacher will come and extend the invitation.
I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord until I
church say amen. Amen. If you were touched today and fed by the word of God, say amen. 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 We will turn it over to our to Devaney, please.
Good morning, church. We have several people here this morning. I'm just gonna state, but we have Brother Jack Choice. He's coming up for prayer today, and he would like to make a statement. We have Tyrone Frampton. He would like to make a statement. And we have his brother, Terry Frampton. Frampton. He would like to make a statement. And today we also have Linda Miller, and she's coming up for prayer today.
Amen. We can start. Let's start with Brother Choice.
Hello, Terry. Come before you today to ask for your prayers. I was just informed yesterday that one of my daughters died. I have two daughters that, you know, Denver and one in Indiana. But the youngest one, Lisa Jackson, just died. And don't know everything about how and all that. It was just something that happened. So, you know, I just ask for your prayers. Okay. Thank you.
All right. Let's move to the Framptons, please.
Okay. I just want my brother to know that I love him. That's all.
I'm sorry, but God is gonna help me. But you know I love you, bro.
I love you too, man.
You know I'm sincere.
Yes, indeed.
And I'm sorry, everybody don't understand.
They don't know what's going on. We okay.
Good. All right. I just wanted to tell him the same thing he told me.
All right. Sister Miller, she's come for prayer. All right, if we can have some deacons come around, Brother Choice. My stepfather.
If y'all stay up, get Brother Clancy to put lay his hands on the two Frampton brothers. Y'all sit next to one another if you don't mind. Brother Miller is coming for prayer, am I correct? Okay. If I can get a deacon to lay hands on Sister Miller.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, we are here right now. You're here, Heavenly Father, just thanking you for being the center of our life. Father God, we know that greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. And we ask now, O Lord, that you would touch Sister Miller, that you would touch the Frampton brothers. We don't know the situation, Heavenly Father, but we know that you are in charge, and we know that you have all things under control. Heavenly Father, we look to the hills from which cometh our help, hallelujah, for we know that our help comes from on high. We know that you are able to deliver where we need to be delivered. Father God, we know that you are able to heal where we need healing, and you said you would do it, and we just trust, Heavenly Father, in your holy name. We thank you, Father God, for the precious blood that was shed on Calvary's cross. Where we have, Heavenly Father, we have, dear Lord, we can come to you. Dear Lord, it's your blood that covers us, Father God. It's your blood that cleanses us, Heavenly Father. It's your blood that cleans the slate. And I know, Lord, that is the blood that shall never lose its power. For it reaches to the highest mountains, hallelujah, and it flows to the lowest valleys. So we just thank you for being present in our life. We just thank you, Heavenly Father, for comforting us where we need to be comforted. Father God, we ask prayers, Father God, for Brother Choice, Heavenly Father, for his daughter, Heavenly Father, for Lisa, Heavenly Father. We just ask, dear Lord, that you would touch and be with them over this situation. Father God, precious in our eyesight is the passing of one of your saints, dear Lord. And we just thank you now for all that you have done. We thank you for all that you are doing. And in Jesus' name, we pray this prayer. And all God's children said, amen. Amen.
You've been so
over the building. Item. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand really high. Raise your hand really high so our brothers can see where you are. If you don't have your Lord's Supper items.
Wash me.
You were holy saints. We're getting ready to two ushers up front. We're going to receive the Lord's Supper waste items. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Brother Francho, if you give us a moment. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Live stream, you see the ways to give to our ministry. Remember our church. If you're not and you want to participate in giving, you see the ways to give. God our Father, we're about to share our gifts via tithe and offering. Don't let us go lacking. We're trusting you to do what your word says you would do. Bless now as we give. In Jesus' name, now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless in the presence of his glory with great exceeding joy, to the only wise God, be full of majesty and glory, dominion and power, forevermore. And the church said, amen. Now, if you would stand all over the building, our ushers will give you directions. And we're going to share our tithes and offering, and we're going to our cars. See you on Wednesday night.
Have you, man? Anytime.